Happy Sabbath, everyone. We are so happy that you are joining us here with our Some TV worship service. Today we have an excellent study from our Three Angels messages that we've been studying, and we will also be having a wonderful sermon by our pastor, David Salazar. So welcome, everyone. We're so glad that you are with us. And we also want to remind you to send your tithes and offerings to your local churches. May we be blessed as we enter into this service.
How many of us know that there is power in the blood? Thank you, Jesus, for dying for us. Number 294, power in the blood.
Welcome again, friends. Happy Sabbath. We're so glad that you decided to join us this week on the Secrets Unsealed and Sun TV Sabbath School Hour, The Church at Study. We hope that in our discussion and in our reading today, that something will be said that will draw you closer to your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so this quarter, we have been studying the three cosmic messages, better known to many as the three angels' messages of Revelation. And we're going to introduce our topic just a bit later, but at this point I would like to introduce our panel. To my right, we have Pastor C.A. Murray, associate speaker here at Some TV and Secrets Unsealed. Pastor Murray, it's a pleasure to have you.
Always good to study the Word of God with men of like faith.
All right. And to my left, we have our president speaker, Pastor Stephen Bohr. And Pastor, it's just a joy to have you continually for the past few weeks to be with us.
It is a delight to be here for this Sabbath School class. You know, I mentioned in the last program that we had last Sabbath that my favorite program is I'd Like to Know, hands down.
Hmm.
But Sabbath School class is a very close second.
Well, so we're working pleasure. On moving that up.
Amen.
All right. Our lesson this week is called A City Called Confusion, and we'll deal more with that introduction as we get into our lesson. But for now, we would like to ask Pastor Bohr if he'll pray for us, and Pastor C.A. if you'll read our text for the morning.
Mm-hmm. Father in heaven, as we study this very important lesson about the city of confusion, Babylon, that you'll be with us, not only with us as we present, but also with all of those who are going to watch this program. We know that this is an extremely important topic that we're going to deal with. The world is in confusion today. Help us understand the significance of what we're going to look at. And we thank you for the promise of your presence. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Our memory text for this particular Sabbath is found in Revelation chapter 17, verse 14. I'm reading from the New King James Version. The Bible says, "These will make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and those who are with him are called chosen and faithful."
All right, very good. Again, our topic this week, a city called confusion. Now, the great controversy theme is summarized in Revelation with the symbolism of two women. In Revelation 12, we have the woman who is dressed with the sun and in the dazzling glory of Christ. In Revelation 17, we find a woman dressed in scarlet and purple. And in very much contrast with the woman of Revelation 12. This week's lesson, we'll study these two women of Revelation and probe more deeply into the conflict and the truth and error that resides in these two women. Now, of course, we know that in Scripture, a woman is the symbol for a church. And then if Revelation has this woman who is dressed with the sun and represents Christ, she is a pure woman. In Revelation 17, we have one who is dressed in scarlet and purple and called a harlot. And this then is an impure woman. And so we can assume then, if we're using the women as symbols, that we're talking about a church that is unadulterated, that is pure, as opposed to a church that is impure, that has error as the basis for its beliefs. Now, we're going to take a look at these two contrasting systems. And so let's look at Revelation 12, 17. Pastor Bohr, if you'll get that for us. And Pastor Murray, if you'll get Revelation 17, 14. Let's see how these two systems are described.
You know, before we dash to that, we have established, and we know quite well that a woman in prophecy is the church and vice versa. It's not going to be found in Revelation per se. So someone is looking for that, they're not going to find it there. You've got to go back to the Old Testament, mm-hmm. and it's established in Jeremiah 6, 2. But it's one of the things we said several lessons ago, and it really fits for all of these lessons. There is gold to be found here, yeah. but it's not lying on the surface. Yeah. You've got to dig. And you've got to dig. You got to go back to the Old Testament, come back to the New Testament. You've got to dig. There is much gold to be found, but it's not just lying around. If you search, you will find it. So the idea of a woman equaling the church, a church equaling a woman, is back in the Old Testament in the book of Jeremiah. So I just want to establish that before we go off.
All right. So Pastor Bohr, you had Revelation 12. 17.
Yes, Revelation 12, verse 17 reads as follows. "And the dragon was enraged with the woman. And he went to make war with the rest of her offspring who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ."
Okay, now make a little commentary there, because I know you don't particularly like that translation of of the seed.
Yeah, you know, the King James Version translates, as probably many of us know, "He went to make war with the remnant of her seed." Mm-hmm. And of course, the woman's seed is Christ. He's been identified earlier in chapter 12. So the remnant of her seed is the remnant of Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Okay, very good. Now, Pastor Murray, if you will read yours.
You were giving me
Revelation 17:14.
17:14. These will make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and those who are with him are called chosen and faithful.
Okay, so here the contrast is pretty great. We have one group that, as you read, Pastor Bohr, that seems to be in direct opposition and conflict to the other. This group is making war. Mm-hmm. So the inhabitants of the earth then must decide which of the two camps they will find themselves in, which they will choose to be in. Mm-hmm. Revelation 12:17 describes the faithful as those who keep the commandments of God, and they're called the chosen and the faithful. Mm-hmm. And the other group is in direct opposition to them, making war with them. Let's look at Revelation 14:8, and then Revelation 17:1-2. 14:8 says, "And another angel followed, saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication." Now, we started talking about a church, a woman, and now we're talking about a city. How do we connect these three items so that we understand the symbolism being used?
Well, you know, we're not dealing with the literal city of Babylon. That was destroyed a long time ago, millennia ago. We're dealing here with a system that actually has the same principles that ancient Babylon had. Okay. In other words, we're not dealing with a literal city in a literal valley with a literal tower being built next to the literal River Euphrates. You're dealing with spiritual Babylon, which is a global apostate system against God.
Okay, very good. And so, but this is identified as this harlot woman in Revelation 17.
Right.
And a woman is symbolizing a church as an apostate church.
Yes.
Okay, very good. Now in Revelation 17:1-2 it says, "Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came and talked with me, saying to me, Come, I will show you the judgment of the great harlot who sits on many waters, and with whom the kings of the earth committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth were made drunk with the wine of her fornication." And so, Pastor C.A., work this for us so we can see more clearly this opposing force. Mm-hmm.
One of the things that we established some time ago is that Revelation gives you several keys to understanding. If you don't pick up the keys and sort of put I'd rather say mosaic together, the picture gets a little cloudy. But if you pick up the keys and add key to key, then you have an understanding of what we're dealing with. When we talk about Babylon, we're talking about a system, a mindset that exists. It's played out in these last days through what we see in Revelation 17. So the woman who equals the church develops this mindset. She has the same mindset as Babylon does. It's confusion, but it's not confusion for confusion's sake. It's directed confusion. It's purposeful confusion. Mm-hmm. It's confusing because it wants to be confused. So this woman now, it says fornicates. She has relations with governments and powers and entities, so she spreads her poison, if I can use that term, throughout the world. She affects many governments. She affects many kingdoms, not one time, but through millennia. Mm-hmm. And in these last days will rear her head again. So when you come with that mindset that there is a religious system exemplified by this woman who is affecting governments and affecting people and affecting nations and poisoning them because they are, quote, fornicating with her, then we get an understanding that this is a worldwide global religious system that is being used by the enemy to attack the people of God.
And we know that it's a global system because she's sitting on many waters.
Yes.
And the many waters are identified in verse 15 of Revelation 17 as multitudes, nations, tongues, and peoples, which means that she rules globally. Mm-hmm. And so this is a global system. It is an apostate church because it's spoken of as a harlot. Uh-huh. She fornicates with the kings of the earth, which means that it's a church that is involved with the political systems of
precisely,
the world.
Precisely.
And so you start to find characteristics that help us identify who this power represents.
Okay, so now, you know, if we've followed any of the news for the last 5 minutes, there is much talk about the necessity in America for the combination of government and church. There's much talk about that. And so, a question, why is this alliance with this woman and the kings of the earth called fornication? Why fornication?
Because the church is supposed to be only married to Jesus Christ.
Precisely.
And when the church gets involved in politics, the church is committing spiritual fornication or adultery. Mm. She's forsaking her legitimate husband. And that's the reason why this system is apostate, is because it depends on the political systems mm-hmm. of the world to do what it wants rather than being linked with Christ and Christ doing yes. what is supposed to take place with the church.
Okay. And so there is this kind of symbiotic relationship that exists between these two entities, the church and the state, mm-hmm. because the church needs the state to execute its agenda, but the state then needs the church to gain the favor of the proletariat, so to speak, of the people.
Right.
Yeah. And so they're interdependent.
Yeah. You know, it is true that they're interdependent, but history has shown whenever church and state comes together, church is in the ascendancy. Church has the ability, because of the way it proffers itself as speaking for God and being able to anathemize people. It gets the state to do its bidding. Mm-hmm. So it's a relationship. I don't know if it's purely symbiotic, because when I say think symbiotic, I think something that builds each other up.
Yes.
Well, I guess these do build each other up in a negative way.
Right, yeah.
You know, one gets the other to do what it was. And the loser, the person that's on the receiving end of all of this blasphemy and all of this fornication, is the people of God, or are the people of God.
Yeah.
And you know, it's very clear that this is an illegitimate relationship.
Mm-hmm.
And we know that it's illegitimate because the time is going to come when the kings of the earth are going to hate the harlot.
Mm.
Which shows that that the union between the harlot and the kings of the earth was illegitimate.
Yes.
When the kings wake up and they see that this false religious system has influenced them to do her bidding contrary to the will of God, then they will no longer support her.
Yes.
That's in Revelation 17, verse 16, where it says that they will hate the harlot and they will make her desolate and naked. They will eat her flesh and burn her with fire. That's a way of saying that they're going to be pretty mad at her.
They're going to be pretty upset. Yeah.
They'll be a little ticked off.
Yeah. The river's going to dry up and all the support will be gone.
Yeah. Now, you know, Jesus, in speaking to Pilate, when Pilate asked him, are you a king? Jesus said, my kingdom
is not of this earth.
It's right. Not of this world. Yeah. And so Jesus outlined for us that the church is separate from the political
right.
systems of the world.
Yeah. He it's also
separate
said,
from the state.
Therefore, render to Caesar
yes. mm-hmm.
what is Caesar's, and what to God what is God's. You know, and I like to give this example. Is it legitimate for Caesar to ask the church to pay taxes? No. Is it legitimate for the church to ask for Caesar's money to build a church? No.
No.
Each one is to rule in their sphere, the state in civil matters, the mm-hmm. church in religious matters,
yes.
but they are to remain separate, because once they're united, the Bible describes it as fornication.
Yes. All right,
yes.
good. Good. There may be many viewers who are watching, and they read and they hear about this fornication, but they're not certain how this combining of the religious and the civil becomes fornication. Mm-hmm. And so, I wanted to just take a little moment to get that kind of spelled out. There is a statement here in Revelation 17:2, where it says that the inhabitants of the earth were made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So we're not talking about literal things now. And so how is it, Pastor C.A., can you enlighten us how the inhabitants of the earth become drunk with this fornication?
If you look at the combination of church and state, it has never been good. It has never been positive. So the inhabitants of the earth are reeling under the pressure or the I'm trying to think of an appropriate word. This religio-political power has the ability to force its way into the minds, into the hearts of the people of the world, from kings on down. So they are made drunk in that they are seduced, is maybe a good word, by the wills and the ways and the wiles of this entity.
Yes.
And as such, it is well compared to being drunk.
Yeah.
It's very difficult. I have found it to be very difficult to find the symbolic meaning of wine in the Bible, because almost every single reference refers to literal wine. And then one day I was reading Revelation 17 once again and trying to figure out what is the wine that this harlot has in her cup. And then I discovered something very interesting. And it is that Revelation 17 tells us in verse 2, with whom the kings of the earth committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth were made drunk with the wine of her fornication. Mm-hmm. And then I continued reading verse 4.
Yes.
The woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet and adorned with gold and precious stones and pearls, having in her hand a golden cup full of abominations. Mm. So the wine are her abominations.
Yeah.
And then I said, let's look up in the concordance the word abomination.
Yes, yes.
And then you find a very powerful explanation of what abominations are.
Yes.
They are worshiping the sun, worshiping idols, thinking that you can be saved by your works, thinking that you can be saved in your sins, delving into the occult, among other things. So the wine are her false teachings or her false doctrines contrary to the Bible.
Give us a textual reference real quick for that, so for those who are listening.
Oh, I have lots of...
There's one in particular that...
The sun, worship of the sun.
That
is in the lesson. It's Ezekiel chapter 8 and verse 16.
Okay.
Their backs were the temple and they were facing the east and worshiping the sun. And some people say, well, it's not the same thing to worship the sun as to worship on the day of the sun. And in principle it is. And I usually give it this explanation. You know, I ask people, who created the sun? Well, they'll say God. Did he create it for worship? They'll answer no. So what happens if you make it an object of worship?
Idolatry.
Oh, they'll say idolatry. Then I'll ask three other questions. You know, who made the first day of the week?
God.
Oh, God.
Yes.
Did he make it for worship?
No.
So what happens if you make it a day of worship?
Idolatry.
It's still idolatry.
Yeah.
And so, you know, people are not stupid enough to bow and worship the sun to the east, at least in the Western world these days.
Yes.
But by worshiping on Sunday, they're following in principle the same thing. Because they're worshiping on a day that God did not establish for worship.
Yes. Now, I'm interested a little bit in this concept of being drunk, you know? What is it about their... I My grandfather ran a cafe for 50 years in Los Angeles, and so many a person stumbled out of the door after imbibing too much alcohol. You know, it was obvious from their speech and from their behavior they were drunk. But what about this union? Why does he use the illusory language of drunkenness? What is it? How is it they become drunk? What is it they display that makes them drunk?
Have you ever tried to argue a point with a drunkard? A drunkard is always right.
Yeah.
He will never admit that you're right. And furthermore, have you ever tried to give a Bible study to a drunk? Their ability to understand is impaired.
Mm-hmm.
And false doctrine does the same thing.
Okay.
Spiritually speaking.
Yes.
Some people have imbibed false doctrine so much, they're so drunk with false doctrine, that when you try and teach them the truth, you say, I don't see any light in that.
There you go.
Yeah.
And so that is the issue here when it comes to wine. By the way, the second angel's message, which is really what we're discussing here in this lesson, tells us specifically why Babylon fell.
Hmm.
It says in verse 8.
Of chapter what?
Chapter 14, Revelation 14, verse 8. And another angel followed, saying, Babylon is fallen, is fallen. By the way, when it repeats the word is fallen, it means that it's really fallen. And then it says the reason why. Another angel followed, saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because.
Mm-hmm.
Why did Babylon fall? Because she has made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication.
Mm-hmm.
So what led to her fall was giving wine to the nations. Basically, you have to connect the first angel's message with the second angel's message. The reason why Babylon fell is because she refused to accept the first angel's message.
Mm-hmm.
The first angel's message is the pure grape juice,
yes,
if you
yes.
please.
Okay.
But Babylon rejected the first angel's message, which teaches us that we should keep God's commandments, fear God, that we should reflect His character,
mm-hmm.
that we are now in the hour of God's judgment,
yes.
which means that the dead are dead until their name comes up in the judgment.
Right.
That says that we're supposed to honor the Creator mm-hmm. by keeping His Sabbath.
Mm-hmm.
Babylon, by rejecting the first angel's message, it now gives wine, the wine of false doctrine, to the world, and the world becomes so drunk that they're not able to grasp the truth.
Yeah. Now, we find an example of this illicit relationship between church and state, so to speak, in the trial and crucifixion of Jesus,
mm-hmm.
where the church brings him to Pilate and says, he's broken the law. And Pilate says, well, he hasn't broken one of our laws. You
right.
deal with him.
Uh-huh.
And they say, well, we can't execute.
Can't do it.
Right. We need the state.
Yeah, we need the state to execute him. Uh-huh. And so, you know, by duress and a lot of jocularity and all,
mm-hmm.
They were able to get the state to do the biddings of the church
mm-hmm.
and execute an innocent man.
Yeah.
This is the height of drunkenness.
Mm.
When Pilate comes out and says, I find no fault, they say, we want him crucified. And then the state moves through and does the biddings of the church. Now, the people are not able to hear the truth that there is no fault in this man.
Yeah.
Because the system has given them the Kool-Aid, the wine, and they have drunk it.
You know, such is the ability of this worldwide system to impose its will on the world. I've heard people that I've studied with say, well, I'm a member of this church, and there's nothing you can say
right.
that will take me out of it. And even if they admit you're right, I'm staying. Well, that's a drunken man. That's a man who's or woman, who's senses have been so benumbed that they're just not hearing, they're not thinking, they're not seeing, as Pastor Bohr alluded to. And that's what happens when this power exercises its authority. People are swooned by, they are made drunk by, they are made irrational and unreasonable by this power. So even if you give them Bible, if you give them doctrine, they're not ready, willing, or able to receive it because they've been made drunk by imbibing this power.
And it's called the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Jeremiah 51 verse 7 tells us, Babylon was a golden cup in the Lord's hand that made all the earth drunk. The nations drank her wine, therefore the nations are deranged. And you know, in the case of Christ, which you were mentioning, that group that shouted, crucify, crucify him, were deranged.
Yes.
They were so caught up in the false doctrines and traditions of the scribes and Pharisees that they could not fathom releasing Jesus rather than releasing Barabbas.
Yes. Yes.
And so in the end time, the harlot is going to be filled with rage against God's people, and she's going to give wine to the nations so that they are enraged against God's people. And that's the reason why in Revelation 17, verse 6, it says that she is filled with the blood of the saints and with the martyrs of Jesus. In other words, she shares her rage with the multitudes, and then the multitudes persecute God's faithful people.
Yes, yes. That's the height of drunkenness, you know, when we can't make correct moral judgment because our minds are so preset that we can only see one way, even if it's not the right way. There's no moral reasoning.
Yeah. Could I read this statement?
Please.
Great Controversy 389. When faithful teachers expound the Word of God, there arise men of learning, ministers, professing to understand the Scriptures, who denounce sound doctrine as heresy, and thus turn away inquirers after truth. Were it not that the world is hopelessly intoxicated with the wine of Babylon, multitudes would be convicted and converted by the plain cutting truths of the Word of God. However, religious faith appears so confused and discordant that the people know not what to believe as truth. The sin of the world's impenitence lies at the door of the church.
Wow.
Powerful statement.
Yeah, yes. That's sobering for pastors.
Yes, it is.
It is.
That's very sobering.
And for church members, we just here in Fresno just this week, there's a church that has been vandalized, and they are a pro-LGBTQ church, and that's why they were vandalized. They had a drag show in the church, you know, kind of thing. So when people look at the church, they don't know what to think, and it started with Babylon. So now there's all manner of confusion, and the world is literally drunk with this wine. They can't make sense of the church. Churches aren't standing up for what they are supposed to. So you look and you say, where is truth? Where is God? Where is the Holy Spirit? I don't see it in many of the churches. And that's deliberate confusion. There's a power saying, I want the confusion. I want people to not know what to do or where to go or how to respond. And Satan is quite happy when people just, well, I'm just going to reject all religion because I just don't know what is truth and what it's not.
Yeah. Well, I wanted to, you know, because we never know who's watching. And just wanted to give some words of encouragement and hope to those who are watching. In Revelation 18, verse 4, here it says, I heard another voice from heaven saying, and it's speaking, directing this speech towards Babylon. It says, come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins, unless you receive her plagues. It's interesting. He says, come out of Babylon, my people. And so God is identifying that He has people in the apostate system that belong to Him. Mm-hmm. They'll hear His voice and they will follow Him. And so if you happen to be in a system that is teaching some of the wine of Babylon, have heart. God can call you out. Once you see truth, you can't unsee it. You can turn a blind eye to it, but you can't unsee it. And so know that God has not forsaken you. God has not left you. He's calling you to come out of the apostate system.
There is a place for spiritual rehab.
Yes.
Amen and amen. You know, the other side of that coin is this. Everybody cannot be right.
Yes.
You know, I hear commentary on television, well, in this religion, you do this and you do this and that's right. And then for these people, this is right. Well, this text tells me, among other things, everybody is not right. You're being called to come out because that's the wrong way. That's the wrong set of beliefs. So you come out of that to real truth. So it inveighs against the fact that everybody's got a little piece of the truth, everybody's got to be right. No, not at all. God says, here is truth. If you're over here, you're not in truth. So you need to come out of that and come to truth. You know, if you're in a church and you don't believe in that church 100%, and the church does not line up 100% with the Word of God, if it's not a commandment-keeping church, you need to come out of that church because you're banking not only your time on it, you're banking your eternity on it.
Yes.
So you need to follow the Lord, find the right church, mm-hmm. and then pursue that with all due diligence, and don't get stuck in tradition and, well, daddy was and mama was and granddaddy was, that kind of thing. Find the truth for yourself. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the things that this message is saying. Don't graft on the beliefs of your parents or forebears. Find truth and pursue it vigorously.
Mm-hmm. Very good, very good. All right, now I'm going to move on to this the topic of the mystery, Babylon the Great. I'm going to read from Revelation 17, 4 through 6. And here it says, speaking of this harlot Babylon, the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet and adorned with gold and precious stones and pearls, having in her hand a golden cup full of abominations and the filthiness of her fornication. And on her forehead a name was written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and of the abominations of the earth. I saw the woman drunk with the blood of the saints and with the martyrs, with the blood of the saints and of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I marveled with great amazement. Mm. But the angel said to me, why did you marvel? I will tell you the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carries her, which has the seven heads and the ten horns. The beast you saw was and is not and will ascend out of the bottom of the pit and go to perdition. And those who dwell on the earth will marvel, whose names are not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they see the beast that was and is not and yet is. Well, there's a lot in that.
Yes.
There's a lot packed in that. So first of all, let's talk about verse 4, this woman arrayed in purple and scarlet and gold and precious stones and having this cup with these abominations. And so this gives the impression of a system that is sensually appealing. A system that attracts those by the way it looks, and to some degree by the way it behaves.
Artificial beauty.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Not beauty of character, but external beauty.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people are awed by majestic music, and by huge cathedrals. And by marvelous paintings, you know, people awe at all these things. But according to the Bible, it's simplicity mm-hmm. and purity of character
yes.
that is acceptable in the sight of God. Unfortunately, people are wowed by the wrong things.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Isaiah tells us about the Messiah, that there was nothing about him, you know, visually that made people want to follow him.
Yeah.
That wasn't the attraction. The attraction was the inward beauty. Mm. The same of the sanctuary in Israel. Outside, it looked kind of drab. But inside, they were precious things. Mm-hmm. The beauty of the tabernacle was what was contained inside of it. But here, this system is outwardly showy. Now, it also says the mystery, Babylon the Great, mother of harlots.
Mother of anything is mother of anything is the queen of, the chief of, the biggest of, the most gaudy of, that which got it all started. So it, as mother of harlots, it's the seed, if I can use that term, from which all of the others spring or sprang. Mm. The mindset comes from Babylon. This idea of doing it my way, adding to, taking from, shifting around, changing, that idea started in Babylon, and it has infused its way into the churches of today, and certainly the mother church. And we're not trying to throw stones or call names, but you know, if your eyes are open and you're reading, there's not that many organizations that fit this. There's only one really that fits and checks kind of all the boxes, if you want to know. What's interesting, you know, we talk about this. When I was in New York, I noticed that all of the lead cathedrals, all of the big diocesan churches, faced east-west, with the rose petal, the big round window facing east. St. John the Divine, St. Patrick's Cathedral, all the big ones face east-west, and that's by design, you know. Mm-hmm. So in many little ways and in big ways, this church is insinuating itself into the lives of individuals and even other religions.
Yeah.
You know, three or four decades ago, the political ideology of the world was internationalism.
Mm-hmm.
Each nation fending for itself.
Mm-hmm.
But in recent years, it's globalism.
Mm-hmm.
It's the idea of establishing a global system, ultimately in apostasy against God, centered in man, in the technology of man, the greatness of man. And the lesson brings us to the origin of the word Babylon.
Mm.
So in order to fully understand Babylon in the book of Revelation, we have to understand Babylon in Genesis chapter 11.
Yes.
I just like to read from Patriarchs and Prophets 1:18 and 1:19 what the objectives of the original Babel builders were.
Okay.
Here they decided to build a city, and in it a tower of such stupendous height as should render it the wonder of the world. These enterprises were designed to prevent the people from scattering abroad in colonies, which was God's plan.
Right. Mm-hmm.
God had directed men to disperse throughout the earth, to replenish and subdue it. But these Babel builders determined to keep their community united in one body. Makes us think of Revelation 17, these will be of one mind.
One mind.
Mm-hmm. And to found a monarchy that should eventually embrace the whole earth. Thus their city would become the metropolis of a universal empire. Its glory would command the admiration and homage of the world and render the founders illustrious. The magnificent tower reaching to the heavens was intended to stand as a monument of the power and wisdom of its builders, perpetuating their fame to the latest generations. In other words, it was a project based on human arrogance,
there you go.
Human wisdom, human greatness, human technology, without any regard for God.
Hmm.
And that's exactly what's happening now. The idea of uniting the whole world in a camp. You know, these days things are consolidating. You know, there's not this idea of dispersing.
Yes.
The idea is these conglomerates,
right,
gathering together.
Yes.
Globalism. And so the same thing is being repeated as what happened at the Tower of Babel.
I think his point is well taken. The mindset is whatever God wants, we don't want that.
Mm-hmm.
God calls for piety, we don't want piety.
Mm-hmm.
God calls for simplicity. We don't want simplicity. God calls for one-on-one relationship to guide your spirituality. Well, we want ritual. You know, we don't want that. So the mindset of Babylon is, we don't really care what God wants. This is what we want.
Right.
And the mindset of many churches today, although it doesn't seem so because it's housed and clothed very, very, very adeptly, is God wants this, but we want this. Mm-hmm.
Right.
And we're going to go with this.
Yes.
You know, that's the mindset. And that's what's in the cup.
Mm-hmm.
Not what he wants, what I want.
Right.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes. Well, a couple of things I just wanted, you know, I watched a program. I can't remember what program, who did the program, but it was talking about the science and technology of the Babel builders. And with unbaked brick, their idea would have certainly failed. But the technology existed to bake brick then.
Mm-hmm.
And with baked brick,
mm-hmm.
it could have raised the tower to an enormous height. The ability of brick to withstand the pressure applied as they went up,
mm-hmm.
well within their grasp, have that technology to build that kind of structure. Now,
in Patriarchs and Prophets, Ellen White gives two reasons why they were going to build the tower. Number one, so that they could scientifically explain the reason for the flood.
Right.
Which means a denial of God,
because
God was the one who sent the flood. And secondly, so that they could save themselves in case there was another flood.
Another one. Yeah.
By building a tower higher than what the waters had reached. And so that basically is the same mindset that is used today. Total independence of God.
Yes.
Underlining the greatness of man.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes. Okay, now back here to the mother of harlots. So this is something I heard in one of your sermons that I had never heard. This was 18 years ago or so. Dealing with this Revelation 17 and verse 5.
Yeah.
Where she's called the mother of harlots. And you said, I've never...
Yeah.
And never seen a mother who did not have daughters.
Or children.
Or children, yeah. Or, I'm so okay, I should say.
But these are
children.
Women harlots in Revelation 17.
Yeah, didn't have children. And so there is a connection between this system and those that are aligned or emanate from this system.
Yeah.
The system does not exist in a vacuum.
Yeah. Actually, Babylon has a restricted sense and it has a broader sense.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
In the restricted sense, the harlot is Babylon.
Yes.
Which I'll say is the Roman Catholic system. On the other hand, Babylon has three parts. Revelation 16, verse 13 says, I saw coming out of the mouth of the dragon.
The beast.
Out of the mouth of the beast.
Out of the wrath.
And out of the mouth of the false prophet.
Yes.
Three evil spirits like frogs. And this threefold union is spoken of as Babylon because verse 19 says that the city, the great city, was divided into three parts.
Three parts, mm-hmm. Yes.
So the three parts are the kings of the earth, the papacy, and apostate Protestantism.
Mm.
And you know, I'll say it openly here. It doesn't mean that people, everyone who is in these systems, understands fully what this means. It doesn't mean that they're necessarily individually apostate. We're talking here about systems
mm-hmm.
of religion.
Yes.
We're talking about denominations. We're not talking about every person that belongs to those denominations.
Very good. Now here, after verse 5 and 6, it says, this woman, this harlot, was drunk with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus.
Sounds like the Inquisition, doesn't it?
Surely does.
Yeah, I watched a program on that last week. Very interesting. Very interesting how the church and the state lined up to accomplish the agenda of both the state and the church. They both got something out of it.
Yeah.
Yeah. The state got to put an iron grasp on its constituents, so to speak, and the church got the state to make the people do whatever they wanted
mm-hmm.
done.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Interesting, one of the commentators who happened to be a priest said, you know, and actually, you know, it was the state who was getting all the goodies.
Yeah.
they got to control the populace, you know. But it's interesting that they're full of the blood of the saints and the martyrs of Jesus Christ. So this system, even though it by profession is the church of God and of Christ, is actually
a harlot.
A harlot.
A harlot.
Not only a harlot, but it's killing those who profess to be, well, I shouldn't say those who profess, but those who are following the scriptural commandments of God.
It's a harlot with claws, you know, the worst kind of harlot, I guess, because it seeks to do away with all opposition. It is wrong, and anybody that's going against its dictates is going to be dealt with, and dealt with severely.
But the harlot at present has a deadly wound.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, the Roman Catholic system at present is not able to use the governments of the world to accomplish her purposes. But the book of Revelation says that the deadly wound is going to be healed.
Yes.
And then she's going to do what she did in the past.
Yes, yes. Okay. Now, in Wednesday's lesson, I think it's the last piece we're going to get to here. There is this call to commitment, a call to commitment. And so I want to look here at Revelation 17:14 here. And it says, "These will make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb will overcome them, for he is the Lord of lords and King of kings, and those who are with him are called chosen and faithful."
Amen.
You know, we have the idea often from when we hear the televangelist speaking and all, that those who align themselves with Christ get a free pass into the kingdom. We're moving through. We're not going to face tribulation. You know, we're on the highway to heaven here, and it's going to be all good. But here, it gives a different scenario, that there is this entity that will make war with the Lamb, but the Lamb overcomes them. Mm-hmm. But we know from our reading of Revelation that there are tough times ahead for the true followers of Christ.
Mm.
There is a time when they won't be able to buy or sell because they haven't received the mark of the beast. There'll be a time when, if they don't have the mark, they will live under the threat of annihilation. And so these are very real threats to the believers of Christ. And it is this system, this apostate system, that is applying the pressure on them. That's why it says she's filled with the blood of the martyrs and of the saints of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
But the good news is that here it says the Lamb will overcome them.
Amen.
Yeah, and I'm always looking for the winner. The Lamb will overcome them.
Yeah,
I've been known to change teams at the Super Bowl in the last 0.2 of a second when that ball is going through the uprights. You know, I love a winner. But here it tells us who wins. We don't have to wait till the end. Don't wait till the end.
That's right.
Yeah,
right.
It tells us that the Lamb overcomes them. And he is Lord of Lord and King of Kings. Not only that, those who are with him are called chosen and faithful. That is a statement of relief.
Amen.
For those who repose in Christ, you know, for those who are in Christ, we know that the victory is ours. And whatever we face here and now and in the future on this earth is just a temporary inconvenience, because heaven will be cheap enough.
Mm-hmm.
The three young men in the furnace were delivered by the Son of Man. Daniel in the lion's den was delivered.
Yes.
And Daniel chapter 12 verse 1 says that from the time of trouble, your people will be delivered.
Yeah.
Everyone who is found written in the book. So we need to make sure that we're on the Lord's side.
That's right.
Make sure we're on the right side of the issue.
That's right. And so, friends, I want to say to you today, if you have heard something that troubles you or causes you some discomfort, pray about it. Look towards the Scripture. Study your Bible. The Lord wants you in His kingdom. He wants to increase the borders of His kingdom with your name in the book of the Lamb from the foundation of the earth. God bless you. See you next Sabbath.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you once again, Lord, for allowing us to come together to worship you today. I pray that you will be with us as we open your word. Allow us to receive your Holy Spirit and lead us into all truth. We pray all this in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Hello, boys and girls. It's Auntie Carolyn here to tell you another story about God's creatures. Today, I want to tell you about the walking stick. Walking sticks are very interesting. One evening, I saw something on a branch, and it was kind of moving. So I went closer and closer, and I looked, and I saw that it was about a 6-inch walking stick. Now, walking sticks can get to be 13 inches tall, long, and they have several sets of legs. What they do is they stand on two pairs of legs, and then they stick the other pair out in front, and it kind of just hangs there. They kind of look like a sword or something sticking out. Now, they don't move very much because they don't want birds to find them, and they don't want to get eaten. And so they just stay quiet during the day, and sometimes they'll make a little shivery, kind of like a real gentle movement. And it's like a breeze was blowing a stick. They eat the foliage at night. And if a bird should come and pick off its legs, it can repair them if they're young. Now, the older walking sticks, they won't grow back. But the younger ones can grow back. And because there aren't very many male walking sticks, the female will lay her eggs, and they won't be fertilized, but they will look just like the mother. They will like her same kind of foods. They will like her same kind of tree, and they will stay, and they will blend in with the branches on the tree. Now, Jesus doesn't want us to blend in like that, does he? We are to represent Jesus Christ. We are to look like him, act like him, talk like him. All manners that we do, we want them to reflect Jesus to all those around us. Boys and girls, remember, ask Jesus to help you to avoid the pitfalls of the world because there's so many temptations out there. Help him, ask him to help you. Ask him to just be with you, help you always to reflect Christ in everything you do. Let's say a little prayer now, boys and girls. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for these wonderful creatures that you've made that we can study and learn about. We also thank you that you're so patient with us and that you're so kind with us. Please help us to always reflect everything about you, our words and our actions, everything we do, may it represent you and give glory to you. We ask these things in your precious name. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of John, John chapter 6 and verse 51. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I shall give is my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world. May the Lord add a blessing to the hearing and to the reading of His Word.
Thank you. Psalm TV is a worldwide Christian ministry providing Christ-centered programs with clarity and power on topics such as Bible prophecy, end-time events, Bible interpretation, tips for healthful living, cooking demonstrations, and much more. Our programs provide practical counsel for daily life and assurance in these uncertain times. Download the free Some TV app or watch online at sumtv.org. You will be blessed.
Hello, friends. Thank you once again to join us here at Worship Hour. I am Pastor David Salazar, and I'm delighted to be able to share with you today from God's Word. It is very important to always plan in our lives. It's important to make plans for our future, plans for our retirement, plans as far as our children, where they will go to school. It's important to even plan when you want to move somewhere. Recently, as I was moving from Florida to California to be able to join here at Secrets Unsealed, I had to make plans to make that transition, to make that moving. And as you can imagine, it takes a lot of planning and a lot of praying as well, as you are trying to do your best to be able to set your household in order, to pack all things, to put them in the truck, to load them up, and travel from one state to the other. As I was not traveling from just adjacent states, but traveling across the country, I gotta make sure that all the planning was done properly, even the type of route I will take. I was thinking as we were coming, you know, planning what type of conditions are the roads in? Will I find ice, maybe some snow, maybe a little bit of, I don't know, a lot of wind? I was a little scared about those things because you are traveling in a big trailer or a big truck, in this case, the biggest you could find. And this truck was, for me, not very easy to travel or maneuver at the beginning. So I had to make all these plans. But it is always very important and very rewarding to see that when you make a good plan and it comes along together, it comes out well, you benefit from all that planning. But what happens when you are looking into the future and you are not certain about if your plans will pan out as you want them to do it? Have you ever thought about how will your life be in a few years? How about, you know, what will happen when you finish that experience of working and laboring and you have to retire? There are many things that can happen as we are planning that we are not sure about. And today's theme and sermon today is about remembering or reminding ourselves that not often it is according to our plans how our life pans out. I remember not too long ago talking to a young man who was very excited. He wanted to be married. And as you can imagine, when you are young and you want to get, you know, married and you want to be able to have your plans with your wife or your future wife, you are excited about the future. You think that you're going to be able to jump ahead and be able to make plans that are going to be very successful. Nevertheless, this young man was excited and was asking me for counseling. And I was, you know, a little weary. I have a couple of years more in experience in marriage than in this case, this young man. And so I was a little weary as far as his thinking, his planning. As he had many plans in life, you know, I was wondering, will you be able to really support your family? Are you ready to make that transition from having studied and having received a degree to really be able to support a family? And so all these things I was asking and directing him, and he was telling me, yes, I have made plans. I have a good job lined up. I have all these things in place. I already have a place where I will make or build our little house. And so he was very excited and he felt ready. However, it hasn't been but a couple of years since he got married that now all this planning that he made have kind of come to a stop or have not panned out as he had planned. You see, he lost his job right around the time of of the pandemic. And it was just a few months after he got married when this thing happened. So he was now facing a situation that he had no longer work. Then not only was he without a job, but also the financial strains of having to have a house half built really was, you know, pressing on him. Then the issue was his new spouse, his new wife, was not sure if he was really going to be able to sustain the family if he was not working. And so there was all this stress, all this added weight on the marriage. And so he has been asking for my counsel and asking me, you know, what can I do? What can I do now that I don't have a job, that I don't have a place to really have my family? What can I do now that I don't have the money to sustain my family? And someone like him, and I can almost certainly believe that maybe we have gone through that experience, maybe some of you have gone through that experience. When we go and we face a situation that things are not planned or don't come out as we plan them, we get really stressed. And so before we start with today's message, before we dive into God's word, I want to invite you to come with me in prayer as we're going to seek the Lord and to realize that many times when we don't plan something or when we plan something that doesn't come out as we think it is, God actually has a better plan in store. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we come to you today and we want to open your word, we pray, Lord, that you will give us understanding, give us wisdom, lead us into the truth. Help us to prepare ourselves as we know that there are things that are very uncertain in the future. Allow us to really trust in your leading, in your guidance, so that we may not find ourselves in a situation that we will reject you in our lives, that we will not deny your name as many have done. I pray that you will help me to be a vessel of your word. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to first point out to you, what is God's plan for us? If you actually were to ask the Lord that question, Lord, what is the plan you have for me today? What is the plan that you actually have for me to be able to stay in this experience of following you all the way through? I want to be in heaven. I want to meet with you in heaven. I want to be part of your kingdom. Well, very simply, in Revelation chapter 14, verses 1 through 5, we actually see the promise of the Lord to us today, to us as his people. You actually have a beautiful scenery there that John mentions in chapter 14 of Revelation, verses 1 through 5, and I'll read the verses. It says there, "And I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his father's name written in their foreheads. And I heard a voice from heaven, as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of a great thunder, and I heard the voice of harpers harping with their harps. And they sang, as it were, a new song before the throne, and before the four beasts and the elders. And no man could learn that song but the 144,000, which were redeemed from the earth. These are they which were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. They are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and unto the Lamb. And in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God." Here in these verses, we can actually see very clearly how the Lord has a beautiful picture, a beautiful plan for us. The plan for the Lord is not our life here on earth necessarily. He's not thinking about just your future after you work in your retirement years. He's not thinking about the future of your sons or daughters. He's actually thinking of the future in heaven for all his children. That means you, your spouse, your children, your parents, your family. The plan of the Lord, especially for today's last generation, for last day people who will be able to be translated without seeing death, is that they be part of this beautiful group of people, the 144,000, who will not only be able to be in the kingdom of heaven, but they have the blessing, the benefit, that they can follow or go along with the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. In other words, these are the group of people who will follow Jesus throughout all eternity. They will be with him. They will walk with him. They will actually be able to walk and go to whatever world, whatever experience, whatever place Jesus goes, these are the ones that can go along with him. The plan of Jesus to be with his people, especially with those who are part of this last generation, this last group of people in this earth are really special. We cannot even comprehend the dimension of what it means to have Jesus in our hearts and to really be able to walk with him and follow the Lamb wherever he goes. It's really not something that we have really thought about. Nevertheless, this is the beautiful plan for you and for me. Jesus is inviting us that we, if we're faithful, if we understand what it means to follow the Lord, the greatest reward, our greatest reward or prize for following him on this earth is that we will get to follow him all through eternity. Now, why is it that sometimes it's hard for us to really follow the Lord while we're on earth? It's very hard at times to really be willing to submit to the Lord. Like this young man who's going through the struggles of not having financial stability in his home, in his marriage, he's questioning if the Lord is with him. He's wondering and asking me, Pastor, what can I do? My faith is shattered. I'm spiritually weak. I no longer feel happy and content going to church because I don't see the Lord helping me. I've been praying, I've been faithful in my tithes and offerings, and yet I am failing and I'm not able to provide for my family. And so these type of experiences are really hard and really makes us question how we can follow the Lord when we face uncertainties. But there's a story in the Bible that I want to share with you, and it's really probably the first part of this subject, of this sermon in reality. I don't think I can fit all of it in one presentation, so we'll probably split it in two or maybe three. But let's go into the book of Ruth, chapter 1. We can have a story of someone who did not receive the reward of a planned experience. You see, let's go into the book of Ruth, chapter 1, verse 1, and we'll read the story of someone who was really blessed. Let's see, the Bible says the following. Now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. So we see here that we have the experience of one family. This family, who is Naomi, and the man was Elimelech, and his two children, they both were in a place where it was supposed to be blessed with plenty of food. Bethlehem is actually the name, or the name Bethlehem means house of bread, a place where there was supposed to be enough food and enough bread for everyone. But it is in that place, and it's during the time of the judges that were judging in the time of Israel, that this family faces a very difficult experience. You see, this, it says in the Bible that they were in a famine. Famine came to the land. It came to that house of bread, that place where it's supposed to be fertile, where there was supposed to be enough food for them. It's a place where they were supposed to have enough to eat and be merry and be able to be happy. Nevertheless, because of famine, there was a need to seek food elsewhere. You know, it is interesting that this, in the Bible, this experience of famine happened during the time of the judges. And I know this is more of an application than an interpretation, but I believe that we are in a time where we will see the same thing happening, or maybe we're seeing this already happening in this world. We are in the time of judgment. We are under judgment, and we have been in judgment from 1844. The judgment that the Lord has been started, the investigative judgment that is going on, it's actually the time frame when there is a need for real spiritual food. There is a famine, I believe. As a matter of fact, Amos 8:11 tells us that, "Behold, the days come, say the Lord God, that I will send a famine in the land, not a famine of bread, nor a thirst of water, but of hearing the words of the Lord." You see, dear friends, it is very clear that there is a famine coming. or maybe he's already here. Maybe you have been starving for real spiritual food in your church. Maybe you've been starving for really having that food that satisfies the soul, and you're not able to find it. You may read the Word of God, you may read the Bible, but you're not finding that. Maybe we're starting to see that there is a famine going on in this land, and this is why the Lord is telling us there is something happening or coming. And believe me, the time will come when, as the Bible mentions, they will not be able to find any food, any word of the Lord coming to them. But as we go back to the story of Ruth, we see, or in the book of Ruth, of Naomi and her family, we see there that they had to leave that place of food, that place of Bethlehem, and go into Moab to find a place where there was at least something to eat to sustain life. Now, let's briefly go through the second verse and read there what happened. See, and the name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife, Naomi, and the name of his two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, Ephratites of Bethlehem, Judah. And they came into the country of Moab and continue there. And verse 3 says, and Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left and her two sons. So right away, we are seeing a very different outlook to what they had planned. They had been escaping the famine in the land of Judah. They go into Moab, and there in Moab, as they started their life again, something happens. Tragedy arrives to this household. The death of the man, of the father of the family, Elimelech, he died. Now, you may think, why did that happen? Was it because God was displeased for them leaving Bethlehem and going into Moab? Was it because he could not find enough food or work? What really happened? Well, we don't know. The details of the Bible are not really there for us to understand why he died. But the fact is that this man died there in Moab. Oftentimes, we don't understand why things happen in our lives that are difficult to accept or receive. We make plans for something and we think of vacations and going with a family this way or another. We think of going on a trip together. But who plans for a failure in health? Who really thinks, I'm going to be sick in a couple of weeks? I need to make plans for that. Nobody, right? Nobody plans for tragedy. Tragedy is not something you can really be planning for. As a matter of fact, it'll be kind of weird to plan for your own, sickness. Nevertheless, we think that we can make plans as far as, saving some money for a rainy day. We can save some money for when our health fails. But nobody really has or wants something that is unplanned, that is unexpected, that is not going to be a blessing. And in this case, Naomi left Moab following the leadership of her husband. And as she gets there, her husband fails. He dies. Now, Elimelech was not a wicked person. He was not a man who was going against God or turning his back to the Lord necessarily. As a matter of fact, Elimelech, his name has a beautiful meaning. It means the Lord or God is king. The Lord is king. God is king. In other words, his parents wanted him through his name to portray that Israel did not need a king, did not need some king to rule them like the other nations. They believed firmly in the concept of God being the only king. We have judges, and that's it. We're not going to look for a system where one strong man governs us. No. His parents believed in the system that the Lord instituted, which was for the church or for the people of Israel to have a kingdom led by the Lord and judged by those that were called to leadership as judges. Nevertheless, as he did his part in doing what he thought was best, he faced death and died, left that poor woman a widow. Now her sons grew up, and verse 4 says the following. And they took, speaking of the two sons, and they took them wives of the women of Moab. The name of one was Orpah, and the name of the other Ruth. And they dwelled there about 10 years. So we can already see that this family that had been living in there in Moab for about 10 years, they came with perhaps teenage, you know, boys that were in that age frame. They arrived to Moab, and they found themselves, as they grew older, finding attraction to ladies or women from that region. They, of course, married two Moabites who were not really professing the Lord. They were not raised in a household that will honor the name of the Lord, Jehovah, but in an experience that they had, really, where they were just probably idol worshipers. Nevertheless, something appealed to these young ladies about these two sons. Now, you may think, and I used to think this way, maybe you think like me, that the two sons of Naomi and Elimelech were actually not very good children. I will assume that because of what happened to them, how they died right away, that they were probably some wicked sons. But the story really portrays a different scenario. As a matter of fact, the names of Mahlon and Chilion are actually very interesting. Mahlon means sick or sickly. In other words, the first son was a sickly child or a sickly boy. He was not the most strongest of all the lads in the land. He was not an athlete or somebody with a lot of energy or stamina. You know, he didn't have all those things. But yet he was a person that something had in his experience, in his life, that appealed to Orpah and to Ruth. I'm not exactly even sure which one is this wife or the other. But then we have Chilion, whose name also means panning or failing. In other words, Chilion was not also strong. He was not also a strong man. He was not really one that was able to say, I am going to give this woman a good life, you know, long term. They were sickly children. That's what at least their names portray, and most of the time their names meant what their characteristics were. So we see here that these two young men gave not the best prospect as a husband. As a matter of fact, if you actually think about it, they were strangers. They were immigrants. They were not, you know, they didn't belong in Moab. Nevertheless, this woman found in them something that really attracted them to them. So, as we saw this story, they get married, but verse 5 tells us this horrible experience. It says, and Mahlon and Chilion died also, both of them, and the woman was left of her two sons and her husband. So we see here that both sons died. From Naomi's perspective, she's now really facing some terrible, terrible experiences. Her planning is turning out completely the opposite of what she had envisioned. Her plan of being able to escape hunger and escape the famine for a better land, for life for herself and her family, is completely shattered. She's now left alone. And both sons and her husband, they are dead. So now she's left with two daughters-in-law, two ladies, two girls who, against perhaps the custom of those days or the custom of their nation or country, they actually chose to marry foreigners from Israel who did not believe like they believe, who did not practice what they practice, but somehow they felt they had something more than what they could find in their own people. As we see this, we're going to start to realize the experience that Naomi had and who and what type of woman she was. Verse 6 says the following. Then she arose with her daughters-in-law that she might return from the country of Moab, for she had heard in the country of Moab how that the Lord had visited his people in giving them bread. Wherefore she went forth out of the place where she was, and her two daughters-in-law with her, and they went on their way to return unto the land of Judah. So here we see something very unique in her experience. She's mourning the loss of her family, of her husband, her two sons, and now she decides to stand. I need to do something. I need to return back to where I came from. I need to go back to the land of bread, to the house of bread, where there is now food. The Lord has now turned his ear to his people. He now has provided food for them. It is time for me to go back. Her plans had failed. Not what she planned for. She did not receive what she was envisioned as she had left Israel. Now she's actually realizing that her plans had utterly failed. And she decides to trust in God's providence that she was better back in her own household than in a foreign land. So she goes back and decides to go back. Verse 7 says, verse 7 and 8, actually verse 8 tells us, and Naomi said unto her two daughters-in-law, go return each to her mother's house. The Lord dealt kindly with you as ye have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant you that ye may find rest, each of you in the house of her husband. Then she kissed them, and they lifted up their voice and wept. In these two verses, we see something very special that is not found usually in an experience in a relationship between a mother-in-law and her daughters-in-law, you know, between them. It's really unique that a mother-in-law really cares for them so much and says, it is time for you, my young ladies, to return to your households. Find yourselves a husband. May the Lord grant you a blessing to be able to have a household and have a husband that will love you and you can have families. But I need to return. I need to go back. Now, obviously, there was nothing there for her necessarily. There was not any children left. There were not a husband. There were really not much left. And she knew that her condition as a widower in those days was a very difficult one. So she couldn't offer them anything. And she really thought of their well-being before her own. She wanted them not to experience the sadness, the hardships that she felt she was going to experience. As the Lord had taken away from her life those that she loved, she felt that she was really not going to be able to find any happiness in her life, at least not in this earth. Nevertheless, she's concerned more of the well-being of them and begged them and asked them to stay, to be able to really plan for a better life, for a different life, to redo their lives, to change what they were doing, to be able to have a family, to be able to find a new husband to be able to take care of. Nevertheless, both of them really had something special with her. She mentions actually when she's telling them there in verse 8 that they had dealt kindly with her, that she knew, she had felt kindness out of their hearts, that these two young ladies were really special. They had learned to love her. There was a relationship there of almost a mother and daughter type of relationship where there was love, and she felt that they had been so kind to her that she didn't want to let them go, but she wanted them to be happy and find happiness in their lives. Therefore, she asked them to go. And verse 9, she makes this plead to them, kisses them goodbye, and asks them to go. But verse 10, they reply and say, and they said unto her, surely we will return with thee and to thy people. So both of them says, no, Naomi, we are not going to leave you. We love you. Surely we will make our path be binded to yours. Our future is with you. We don't want to separate ourselves from you. There's something about you that we cannot find in any other experience, in any other person, more so than even our own mothers. We love you. We want to be with you. Now, what had Naomi really showed them? But what was in her heart. See, Naomi means pleasant. That's what the name pleasant means. She was a woman that was a pleasant person to be around with. Not only was probably she an attractive woman, and that's maybe why the word pleasant was there, somebody that is pleasant to the eyes, but also her character, her way of being, her personality was a pleasant person. When you find somebody that's pleasant, you usually like to spend time with them. You like to spend time with them and engage with them. I remember, and you probably all who are married can remember that when you met your spouse, there was that experience of being so happy with her or, you know, or with him, because it was a pleasant experience. You felt secure, you felt joyed, you felt happy to be with that person. You didn't seem to really care if it was late at night or if it had to be, you know, put a certain type of challenges to be able to meet with that person or be with that person. You were willing to put up with a lot of things just to be able to spend time with that person. And I know that Naomi was a person that was very pleasant to be with. That's why they love her. I often ask myself, am I that kind of person? Am I a pleasant person? Do people find me pleasant? And not just because I want to be, you know, liked by people. That's not what I'm saying. But do really people like me because I am reflecting the Lord? Christ was a pleasant person to be with. He attracted all sorts of people, sinners, righteous, those that were sick, those that were whole. He attracted the children, little kids, would love to come to the Lord. Jesus was that type of person that was pleasant, is actually the type of person that's a pleasant, and that's why he's invited us to join him, to come to him. And in this situation, we see that Naomi had that character very similar to Jesus. I believe Naomi had that type of character that was a blessing to others. As a matter of fact, the fact that she was thinking of her daughters-in-law more than her own well-being shows you the type of character she had. She actually loved them. And so she thinks, no, it's not good for you to do this. Verse 11 says, and Naomi said, "Turn again, my daughters. Why will ye go with me? Are there yet any more sons in my womb, that they may be your husbands? Turn again, my daughters, go your way, for I am too old to have a husband. If I should say, I have hope, if I should have a husband also tonight, and should also bear sons, would you tarry for them till they were grown? Would you stay for them from having husbands? Nay, my daughters, for it grieved me much for your sakes that the hand of the Lord is gone out against me." So here we see the true beauty of the character of Naomi. We see in these words how she's saying, listen, I can't provide you happiness. I can't provide you fulfillment for your lives. I can't provide you sons anymore. And even if I had, I'm already old enough, but let's say that I was to have a husband, even now, tonight, if I had a husband to be with, and I could have kids, you know, would you wait 20 years for them? It doesn't make any sense. She's saying, please, don't think like that. You know, I need you to forget about me. Your happiness is more important to me. Make a new life. Do what makes sense. Go find yourself a husband. Have a happy life. Have children. Be blessed by the Lord. And please, don't worry about me right now. Worry first about yourselves. It actually, in verse 13, she actually makes the point that it grieves her more, the condition of them having no children, than her own condition. She says, it grieves me much what you're going through. She's like, I lost my husband, I lost my children, but I'm more concerned, I'm more worried about your condition, your situation, your experience. It grieves me even more to think about you missing in life because you wanna be with an old woman like me. This is a beautiful thing about the character of Jesus too. He worries about you. He actually loved us more than himself, and he gave his life to save you and me so that he may find that redeeming multitude of people who his blood secured. His joy was in seeing us redeemed from the doom of sin. And it is why I believe this story really portrays more the type of character of those who will be with Christ whosoever he goeth, wherever he goeth. It's the type of people that really are going to be with Christ because they reflect his character. Naomi is one of those people that really had that experience when she was on this earth, when she was alive. She actually felt more love and sympathy for those around her than herself. And so as she asked them, verse 14 says, and they lifted up their voices and wept again, and Orpha kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clave unto her. Look at this experience, this beautiful experience of what it means to have a character like Christ. Ruth, a Moabite, a woman who had no knowledge of the Lord prior to meeting Naomi, somebody that was, you know, idol worshiper perhaps, probably a sinner, obviously, in all sense of the word. But when she found the household of Naomi, she married a son, and then she decided, I need to be with this woman, no matter what. I cannot leave her alone. I cannot just leave her in this experience of being by herself. Something about her really appeals to me. And she says to her, verse 16, after actually, let's read verse 15 because it's important part of the story. Naomi says to her, behold, thy sister-in-law is gone back unto her people and unto her gods. Return thou after thy sister-in-law. And Ruth said, verse 16, with words that are so special, entreat me not to leave thee or to return from following thee or to return from following after thee. For whither thou goest, I will go, and where thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, and thy God, my God. Where thou diest, will I die, and there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me, and more also, if aught but death part thee and me. It is amazing, these words that we hear here from Ruth. But these words are the response of someone who has come to love a character, a person that reflects the kindness that is not seen normally in people. What made Ruth cleave to her mother-in-law? What made her love her so much? Was it financial stability? Was it because she provided her with some sort of family structure? Of course not. She actually had nothing to offer her. But what really made her cleave to her was something that this world lacks, and is a character like Christ. Naomi did not understand. She thought that her experience, her plans had failed. She thought that she had lost everything. And she felt even in her experience, in her mourning, in her situation, she thought, you know, I am not being favored by the Lord. I am going through these struggles, these trials that are so hard, so difficult. I never envisioned this in my life. It's not what I planned for. It's not what I wanted to have. And yet, I am not going to neglect loving God in spite of this. I'm not going to go against the Lord. I'm not going to blame the Lord. I'm not going to say the Lord, you know, he's a bad God. He's not giving me anything. I don't understand why he allows this, but I'm going to still trust him. And that's why I'm going back to Bethlehem, because in Bethlehem, maybe there's something there for me. I don't know. I just know that the Lord has visited again his people, his nation, and I need to be there. I need to go back there. And throughout the experience of sacrifice, of losing sons, or first of all her husband, then her sons, she still showed that love of God in her actions, in her life, to the point that Ruth said, I cannot depart from thee. I cannot go back to the gods that you're telling me, because I don't know anything better than what you have. What you have is so much better, so much more essential to my life, that I will not depart from thee. Only death will make that separation. So please don't insist. Don't beg me to leave you. Don't ask me to leave you. Dear friends, the world is today, like I said, entering a famine for the word of God. But not the word that's just spoken, not the word that is preached in a sermon or through a program. It's really the word that has to be eaten and being part of us. The word that can become in us that hope of glory, that character of Christ being reflected in us, is really what the Lord and the world, is seeking, is lacking to see. Why you don't have food in your church? Why are you not finding in the sermons you hear the word of God? It's maybe because you are not really eating Jesus, his words in your life. You're not really making that part of you. You're not really wanting to reflect his character. Is it really not God's plan for you to love him above all things? And maybe as you are going through struggles, maybe you're going through one right now, maybe you're going through a family member who is in the deathbed, or you have lost somebody recently. Maybe you're going through financial struggles so deep, so hard, that you cannot find food for tomorrow. But still, whatever struggle you're going through right now, whatever plan failed in your life, whatever preparation that you had made is not doing anything for you right now, there is hope. And that is that, like Naomi, if we cling to the Lord, if we hold fast and make Jesus' words our own, new life will spring forth in us. New life will spring forth, and we will be able to really give, perhaps no money, no stability. We might not be able to provide a house, even a financial gains to others, but one thing that we will have that nobody will be able to take away from us, and that really is the most important thing, is that character that reflects Christ. Of course, I'm not speaking of being lazy and not doing your part in working, nothing to do with that, but I'm speaking to us what really is our main plan in this life. What really is it that you're really trying to accomplish? Like Naomi, you can plan ahead for a lot of things and you fail. And those plans are not what you really envisioned them to be. And maybe they are turning into a nightmare in a way. But when you have Christ, when you cleave to the Lord, you hold on to Christ, you will have a character that will be so special to some people, to maybe those around you, maybe to your children, that it will be what will get them to turn back to the Lord and seek him. Have we worked as Naomi our salvation with fear and trembling? Are we seeking Christ daily in our daily walk? You see, in the book of John, chapter 6, we have an experience of Jesus speaking to his disciples. In John 6, verse 51, he was speaking to a large group, including his disciples, and many who were, even though were not the 12, they were disciples of him. And he mentions these words to them. It says there, chapter 6 of John, verse 51, I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. Here, Jesus invites his disciples, invites the multitude, is inviting you and me, that he is the living bread, that we are to eat of him, eat of what he's left for us, his words, his instructions, be willing to accept his direction in my life and say, I am more interested in my daily walk with the Lord, my daily walk with him, than anything else. More than my family, more than my spouse, more than my children, I need to put my time and effort into knowing Jesus and to know him personally. And so when Christ tells them this to the people there, to the Israelites, to those that were there, to the disciples in general that were there, they start really struggling with this idea, this concept. Are you telling us that we are really going having to take your words and eat them, make them part of our lives? Does it mean that what you're telling me, I have to accept that is for my own good, that I have to give up these things that are pleasing to my eyes, to my sight, to my experience? Is it really the Lord you're wanting to change me that much? Well, Jesus had a lot of opposition to these words. If you continue reading the whole chapter, he's reinforcing, explaining what this means. And the same result that happens often when we are facing the truth is that we don't like the truth when it goes against our own inclination, our own will. And so Jesus tells the disciples in verse 67, for it says, verse 66, that from that time, many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. After he said these things, they were offended. They said, I don't want to walk with Jesus this way. I don't want to continue walking with him. I don't like this idea of eating of his words, of eating of his flesh. That concept of having to submit myself to his leading, doesn't go with me. I still have plans to do in this life. And so the Lord tells his 12 disciples, verse 67, then said Jesus unto the 12, will ye also go away? Will ye also go away? Verse 68, Peter answers. Then Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. And we believe and are sure that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. It is, friends, this experience that Peter expressed, this declaration that he believed in Jesus, that he believed in the Son of God, that he was the Christ, that he was the only living thing worth for them pursuing, that they were willing to reject everything else just to follow him. That is, dear beloved, what it means to follow the Lamb. We want to, and we will, by the grace of God, follow the Lamb there in heaven. But it starts here. It starts now. It starts in your life today. And like Naomi, you can go through experiences where you will feel that maybe God is not blessing you, not giving you the opportunity to, you know, to have the things that you want. But seek him first, and you will realize that no matter what happens to your life in the exterior sense, whether you have sickness, death even, or loss of food or loss of money, God will not forsake you. There is something much, much better, far worth pursuing, which is loving the Lord with all our hearts. Reflecting his character is really much, much more rewarding than anything else this world can offer. Naomi was going to experience that in a short while. And we will continue this presentation in the next time we come together here for worship hour. But I want to leave you with this hope that the Lord can and will make your plans much better if you learn to trust him. If you right now are going through a struggle, through a moment of anguish, of sickness, of health, or death, or even financial burdens, please put the Lord first in your life. Put God, Christ, at his word. Put him to the test, and you will see that he will never fail you nor forsake you. May the Lord bless you and guide you is my prayer today.
This hymn is probably one of the most well-known and one of the most beautiful, and it tells us who to look upon when we're in darkness. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, number 290.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for allowing us to study your word and to learn from the experiences there from men and women, what it means to trust you, to love you, to eat your word. Allow us, Lord, to reflect your character. Help us to choose today to serve you, to follow you no matter what happens. And please, Lord, bless those that are watching at home. If they have any struggles, financial instability, if they're going through a difficult time, please, Lord, be with them, comfort them, give them the hope and the knowledge that you will not abandon nor forsake them. Please protect us through this day and allow us, Lord, to be closer to you is my prayer. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.